further contact between Europe and China for hundreds of years after the Polo family had made initial contact with the Emperor Kublai Khan. It was Hong Wu, who became first Ming Emperor, that drove the Mongols out of China. To ensure against their subsequent attacks, he then faced and fortified the Great Wall. The Ming Dynasty was established in 1368 and lasted until 1644. This seems relatively near and modern in the long context of Chinese history. When it began in 1368, many of its scholars considered that the supreme periods of the major arts of China had passed. These included literature, calligraphy, and painting. Following the expulsion of the Mongols, successive Ming emperors sanctioned a limited trade, and now and then missionaries passed through Canton on their way to the court of Peking, where they were granted the privilege of kneeling before the Son of Heaven. Portugal, considered one of the most adventurous of the European seafaring nations, reached China in 1517. From Macau, they traded Chinese and other Asian goods for spices in Europe. It was during the Ming period that an entrepreneurial business class grew up in China. There is a very real idea that the world economic system grew out of the West's fascination with the East and wanting to access her luxury goods. Silks, spices, teas, silver, and superb carved lacquer. From 1405 to 1433, Chinese Ming Empress funded a series of seven voyages into the Indian Ocean to recover trade in the form of tribute from kingdoms in Southeast Asia. They wanted to reinforce their claim to universal authority and satisfy an increasing thirst for knowledge. They visited the Maldive Islands and sailed along the East African coast. They fought off pirate fleets near Sumatra, installed a new ruler at Calicut, and defeated the King of Ceylon. They returned in 1415 to Beijing with a pair of giraffes, a prize considered well worth the cost of the expedition. In China, the giraffe, despite having one horn too many, was celebrated as a unicorn. Their arrival, according to Confucian tradition, meant that sages of the utmost wisdom and benevolence were in their presence. By far and away, the most splendid ceramic wares of the Ming period were made for the imperial court, as well as the more exacting home markets of China. To quote one of the 20th century's most distinguished authorities on antique Chinese ceramics, Robert Lockhart Hobson, "Ming shapes are often distinguished by a certain rugged simplicity, and always by the directness and strength of an art which is still young and virile." The Chinese employed ceramic pots for wine long before they used them for tea, and it is likely that containers with handles and spouts were first introduced for tea when methods of preparing liquid changed. In early times, powdered tea was mixed with boiling water in the drinking bowl itself. But during the 14th century, whole dried leaves of tea began to be used, and these needed to be steeped in hot water to release their flavour. The kilns at Chinchichen, one of the most important of the ceramic production sites of the Ming period, were well established during the reign of Emperor Yongle, 1403 to 1424. This was when the first paper-thin porcelain appeared, its seamless body sandwiched between two lovely layers of glaze. This meant that at last potters had gained complete mastery over material and firing techniques. So what is true or hard-paste porcelain? The original was made from very fine white china clay, or kaolin, which is named for the hill in China where it was discovered. To it, they added powdered feldspathic rock which is called pituns, that when fused together at an intense heat, about 1450 degrees centigrade, produced a kind of natural glass. From the very first time the West accessed these wares, it was seduced by them. Magically translucent, resonant when struck, impervious to liquid and considered refined and aesthetically pleasing in both proportion and style, true porcelain exhibited great beauty of form. It had a fine grained body, white in colour, tinged buff on the unglazed foot ring. Thick glazes were often slightly uneven, with a bluish tinge due to traces of iron, which also conferred the buff colour on the foot ring. The texture of the glazed surface will often exhibit what the Chinese call chicken skin, tiny pinholes in the glazed surface, but this is only a general rule and there are always exceptions. A typical Meiping or blossom vase from the Ming period has a bulbous shaped body, is high-shouldered with a small mouth. It was designed to contain blossom branches each spring, symbolic of the promise of a new year, which generally fell around February or late winter in the Northern Hemisphere. Branches covered with tightly clustered, closed blooms were brought indoors and in the warmth, forced into bloom for the celebration. The seeming magic connected with the firing of blue and white was recorded beautifully by a French Jesuit priest resident in Peking early in the 18th century. He said, "A beautiful blue colour appears on the porcelain after having been lost for some time. When the colour is first painted on, it is pale black. When it is dry and the glaze has been put on it, it disappears entirely, and the porcelain seems quite white, the colour being buried under the glaze. But the fire makes it appear in all its beauty, almost in the same way as the natural heat of the sun makes the most beautiful butterflies with all their tints come out of their eggs." The most prized Ming period porcelains were made in the Xuan Te period between 1426 and 1435, noted for its painting in cobalt blue and copper red. Potters ensured that the wares reached a very high standard of technical and decorative achievement. Examples of Ming ceramics with underglazed copper red are very rare. The mineral copper used to produce the raspberry red tone was notoriously difficult to control during firing and often left the porcelain with a grey or almost colourless coating. Of the small number of underglazed copper red Ming vases remaining, most have suffered some degree of damage. The exception is one rare peony vase whose pattern was expertly executed and colour evenly distributed. Also, it managed to survive without damage despite being used by a Scottish couple as a lamp, not realising its monetary significance, but overjoyed, I'm sure, when it was sold at Sotheby's London in 2006 for over $10 million. Up until this time, it had been usual to apply colour then glaze and have only one firing. But now they experimented with firing the first colour and then painting the second colour on top of the glaze and firing it again, and this proved successful. Cobalt had always been a difficult colour to control, but copper red was so difficult they abandoned it for an iron red enamel that they then painted over the glaze. Discovered at this time, native cobalt deposits had a distinct tendency to run more liberally when used on its own. Also, the colour tended to bluish grey and was not as vivid and alive as the original, more expensive Mohammedan blue from Eastern sources. So many potteries decided to use a blend of the two, but after firing, the native minerals' impurities caused unstable patches in what is now known as heaped and piled decoration, which was one of the main distinguishing characteristics of Ming period blue, and white porcelain. Blue and white wares are the most popular associated with the Ming Dynasty and China, and have by and large remained so until this day. However, it was solving all the problems associated with producing many coloured wares that were its distinct legacy to the future of porcelain manufacture. This is the period when distinguishing ceramics by marking them began. The character for long life, shou, represented in the form of a twisted pine tree trunk, was one of the most used decorative symbols. It meant longevity, and so also did the pine tree, which was trained to be a miniature tree by trimming its roots and branches. This art form, called bonsai, often believed by many to be thoroughly Japanese, was in fact practiced by the Chinese long before the Japanese discovered the technique and made it their own. The Chinese put a great deal of emphasis on symbolism. Bamboo was also honoured as a decorative element on ceramics. A vigorous, long-lived plant, bamboo's branches can be put to a multiplicity of uses, manufacturing everything from buildings to furniture, from eating implements like chopsticks to all sorts of utensils and clothing. Its great beauty is used in gardens. Sticky rice is steamed in it, and young shoots of bamboo are added to many dishes. There is a classic story of three bamboos encapsulating the vicissitudes of life. When the strong winds of difficulty and devastation lay the bamboo very low, magically, it never breaks. When European traders arrived in China early in the 16th century, silk manufacture was adapted to suit market demands. In Florence, head of one of its most famous and influential business families, Lorenzo de' Medici had first learned about the skill of the Chinese silk makers and embroiderers in 1515. He understood that Chinese silk was superior to anything being made in Europe at that time. The variety of surface stitches developed by Chinese embroiderers demanded refined sewing equipment, which they developed as well, such as thimbles, needles with eyes, and needle pushers. Trade with Europe throughout the 16th century was sporadic. The Portuguese established themselves at a succession of key points, including Goa on the Indian coast before 1511, and Malacca, which they seized in the very same year. It was the main junction for the Indies spice trade and the limit reached by the Chinese junks, which came south to exchange cargoes of porcelain and silk. In 1557, the Portuguese were allowed to settle in Macau, and pieces began to come west with seamen on Portuguese carracks. The Society of Jesus, founded at Rome in 1534, also wanted in on what was happening in the East. So from the 1540s onward, they sent missionaries to East Asia. Jesuit priest Matao Ricci, along with his colleagues, learned Chinese, mastered the canon of classical Confucian texts, dressed as mandarins, demonstrating to Chinese intellectuals that the West had far superior skills in areas the Chinese recognized as vital, like cartography and astronomy. When Emperor Wanli, last ruler of the Ming Dynasty, was sitting on the throne of heaven, between 1573 and 1620, Elizabeth I in England was contending with Mary Queen of Scots and other thorny issues. The very earliest written record of Ming porcelain in the West are the pieces specified in Queen Elizabeth I's will, so we can deduce they were highly prized. The Earl of Walsingham and Queen Elizabeth I were financial backers for Sir Francis Drake's circumnavigation of the world in 1577. Drake camped on the coast of California, and a quantity of Ming period China shards, now in the Metropolitan Museum of New York, were excavated from the very spot. In England, during the reign of Elizabeth I, aristocratic families were able to purchase some of the treasures plundered by her privateers from Portuguese carracks sailing back to Europe laden with treasure. In 1600, Elizabeth granted a charter to challenge their monopoly on trade by founding a new joint stock company, the East India Company. The Dutch did the same, founding the Dutch East India Company in 1602. Krak is a Dutch word, probably a corruption of the name for the Portuguese carracks, and the goods they carried was dubbed krakware. The Dutch wanted to wrestle the trade opportunities away from the Portuguese as well, and they captured the Portuguese carrack Catarina in 1603 off the coast of Malaya, and there was much rejoicing in Amsterdam in 1604 when her cargo of about 100,000 pieces of Chinese porcelain were sold on the docks, fueling the demand and fascination with China's goods. The French would come late to the show, founding the Compagnie des Indes Orientales in 1664, but nevertheless they would influence and be inspired by precious cargoes from Cathay as much as everyone else. Enshrining a precious piece of porcelain from Cathay became a practice in the West for centuries. The addition of gilt mounts not only offered a measure of protection against their fragility, but also highlighted the esteem in which they were held. They were considered refined, aesthetically pleasing, with great beauty of form. As in the courts and great houses of Europe, there was a very rich and symbolic language, which people read because they were visually aware and well acquainted with the stories of their culture. The dragon was a mythological beast who symbolized imperial power, and he's often depicted tossing the flaming pearl of wisdom and immortality into the air. Many of the wares of the Ming period were produced at Jingdezhen, where some 60 kilns were working for the imperial court, and some of its most splendid objects were plates painted in imperial yellow over the glaze, which served as a ground colour for designs that had been painted in cobalt blue under the glaze. Wukai, or five coloured wares, belonged to one of the most sumptuous group of wares of the Ming dynasty, characterised by vibrant designs in vivid colours. These pieces tend to have more intricate designs, and the best known Wukai wares are from the reign of the Emperor Wan Li, 1573 to 1620. Ming monochromes covered in a glaze of one colour are famous for their extraordinary depth of tone and are relatively rare. One of the most beautiful is the brilliant red, derived from copper, the colour of sacrifice. It was used both as a glaze colour and also for painting individual designs under the glaze. During the time span of the Ming dynasty, the only decoration permitted on white wares was moulded, carved, engraved, or that which was painted in white slip under the glaze. It's fragile, brittle, and translucent, and needs to be illuminated softly because they are only seen when penetrated gently by light. White is the colour used during periods of mourning in China, and this explains why the choice for this type of porcelain persisted throughout the Ming period and beyond. By the late Ming period, 1573 to 1644, there were new developments in the ancient arts of calligraphy and painting. Literati strove to surmount the petty struggles of what they viewed as a mundane world by devoting themselves to creative artistic activities. They concentrated on heightening an awareness of the individual, his position in the world, and relationship with his fellow man. This led to a simultaneous blossoming of a whole range of new literary forms that in turn affected every other art form, including porcelain. Through mutual discussion and creative interaction, the works they produced attained a high level of artistic merit, tinged with extreme poetic elegance that reflected a healthy attitude towards art and society. The collapse of the Ming Dynasty was a turning point in the history of China. There was a transitional period between the death of the 14th Ming Emperor Wan Li in 1620 and the establishment of the Qing Dynasty in 1644. From 1685, the Manchus would begin their ascent towards the splendor and power they would achieve in the 18th century. But that is for another day. Of late, 'tis true, quite sick of Rome and Greece, we fetch our models from the wise Chinese. European artists are too cool and chaste, for Mandarin is the only man of taste. On every shelf a joss divinely stares, nymphs laid on chintzes sprawl upon our chairs, while o'er our cabinets Confucius nods, midst porcelain elephants and China gods.